Hi, I'm John Overdeck, and thank you, David, for your remarks, and thank you, Pete, Marcus, and the band for the wonderful music this evening. It's my pleasure to introduce our main attraction, our two next guests, our 2017 honoree, Keith Devlin, Professor Keith Devlin, and the host of NPR's Weekend Edition, Scott Simon. As we already learned from the lyrics of the song, quite a bit about them. I can keep these remarks quite short. I'm particularly excited to introduce Keith because he hails from Stanford, where I was once a student. And Stanford has a wonderful tradition of naming things, having funny acronyms for all kinds of things. So he is the co-founder and executive director of the Human Science and Technologies Advanced Research Institute, the H-Star Institute. He co-founded the MediaX Research Network, and he's also a senior researcher at the Center for the Study of Language and Information that we used to call Sicily. I don't know if it's still called Sicily. It is. As well as being an author of 33 books and a decent fine mathematician, he's a great communicator and writer. His passion for communication has led him to be the math guy on NPR since 1995. As you might guess, the name math guy wasn't entirely meant respectfully when he first received it. It was when he was visiting the local California NPR office, somebody would just write up on the schedule math guy as to mean that it's Keith's turn. Joining Keith on stage will be his partner in mathematical exposition for the masses, Scott Simon. We've already learned that Scott has won a Peabody and an Emmy and just about everything in between. I got in my notes an absolutely striking list of awards he's won. I don't know anybody else who's won the Presidential End Hunger Award for the coverage on the Ethiopian Civil War and Famine, the James Beard Award for a story called Conflict Cuisine in Gourmet Magazine, and the Barnes & Noble Sports Book of the Year for his book Jackie Robinson and the Integration of Baseball. So, with that kind of diverse interests and with Keith to speak with, we are in for a treat. Unfettered by the strictures of the FCC and public radio, I am pleased to introduce Keith and Scott for a special live rendition for The Math Guy Unfiltered.
Okay, so before Scott and I start the unscripted part, on your table you'll find little versions of this thing called a Newton's Cradle. You might want to just sort of grab that without getting the things all tangled up. Just see what happens when you, first of all, pull one ball out and let it go. It's sort of somehow there's a mysterious transfer from one end to the other of the motion. And if you are trained in a university or even a high school in sort of classical mechanics, you will say, oh, it's transference of momentum. Or maybe you'll say conservation of energy. Unfortunately, that's not quite what's going on. Those of us who went through a classical education tend to believe the lies we were taught, because 99% of the time those lies work. In fact, that's true of mathematics. I mean, actually, this room is full of quants, and quants know that 90% of the time the mathematics is reliable and 10% it's not. In physics, it's maybe 99%, but we tend to believe it because often, almost all the time, it's true. But it's not always true. Mathematics, I sometimes describe as providing us with lies that are very useful most of the time, because mathematics doesn't really fit the world in its simple form. The world can bite us. To see about the momentum, you would think to yourself, okay, momentum is to do with mass and velocity, so maybe I'll pull two of these out, and then presumably it will transfer to two at the other end. Indeed it does. So you get two going. So it looks like momentum is sort of being passed from one to the other. Well, first of all,
can I ask a question?
Oh yeah, that's his job, right?
So that's not for every action there's an equal and opposite reaction.
No, you do see a little bit of a reaction, because it does bounce back, but it's not the classical Newton thing.
It's another lie that I have swallowed all these years.
Well, you're allowed to tell the lies, because you're not the math guy, but the math guy
is supposed to
tell it true.
That's what we do in the news business anyway.
So,
yeah.
First of all, when you say momentum's transferred, is that magic? I mean, how is it transferred? First of all, let's remember momentum is just a mathematical invention. These things were invented at the time when science was invented, 16th, 17th century period. These things got invented, and they were invented to attach numbers to the world. And so when we say momentum, there's something else must be going on. What's actually going on is that when one ball hits the other, the balls squash. Even though they're steel, they squash a bit. And when they squash, they bounce back out. What's really going on is you've got squashing and bouncing out. You can do that with rubber balls and you can see it more clearly. In the case of steel balls, because of steel, it doesn't absorb much heat. The energy isn't getting dissipated in heat. If you use steel balls, the little bit of squash pulls it out. So what you've really got is you've got a whole wave passing through. In fact, you can get two versions of these things. When you buy them, some of these Newton's cradles, it's called Newton's cradle, some of them, the balls are actually touching. In that case, you can really, if you want to analyze it, you've really got to analyze it by a wave passing along. So it's a squeezing and bouncing out process that's happening. If there's a slight gap between them, then it really is a sequence of nudges. But the model that we have in our mind that momentum is transferred, it's very useful. I mean, we understand things. We send rockets into space using that. It really is useful. You can sort of talk about momentum in baseball and Newton's reaction things. You can talk about it, but it's not actually true. And if you really want to see what's going on, the one you have doesn't do this, but the one I've got, I can take away that guy and replace it with a big one, which is twice the volume and hence twice the mass of the others. So if this was a matter of momentum, if I use that as a driver, I should get the same behavior as using two touching balls coming down, which is what I did. I did two balls, and you saw two go out the other end. So let's just see if mathematics is really accurate. Is it just a matter of momentum? Remember, what we expect to see is two balls moving out and the rest doing almost nothing. The whole thing splays out. You get an interesting pattern, which looks, first of all, you could actually look at the size of these things. You could do a Galileo. You could look at how many things do these come out apart. It looks like some kind of an arithmetic progression. I'm not sure what it is, but it's certainly not the same as the original one. So that simple model we have of momentum being transferred is an effective lie. It's a very useful lie, but it's not capturing the world. So those of you in the quants business, when people go on the radio, and I sometimes go on the radio and say things like this, say, well, you know, they're applying mathematics to a world where they think you can't quantify things so accurately. You have to be in a world of 95% confidence or 100% confidence. Well, guys, guess what? That's true of the physical world as well. Mathematics doesn't actually apply totally accurately. It's an extremely good approximation. Not only is it a good approximation, but thinking about things in terms of momentum actually is useful. So I'm not trying to say forget momentum. It's one of the best models we have. But it is a model, and like all models, it's only true when it's true. And when it's not, you have a financial crash. Okay, on that happy note,
can I begin by saying something about you?
I'm going to anyway.
Okay, I was going to do it anyway, okay.
A little bit startling for me to realize tonight that Keith and I have worked together for 18 years. Mercy.
That's 22 years.
Oh, 22 years.
22,
you're the math guy.
22
yeah,
years.
Right.
Not quite a
poetically, right. That would have been 22 years.
This is why it's
years.
A good team.
I know, how would I? Thank you. That's so embarrassing. By the way, I was told this was a gala tonight, and I've been flying most of the day from Chicago to try and get here and didn't have a chance to change into my Black Watch plaid dinner jacket, which I was going to wear because it's, of course, Keith's ceremonial tartan. I had no idea, though, that dressed this way, just a schlub to fly in an airplane, I would fit right in with a lot of the guests at this gala, so.
You look more like a mathematician than anybody else in the room.
Right, absolutely. Going to stuff some pencils in my pocket just to... We were not looking for a math guy. This is not the sort of thing that a news organization sits down at least 22 years ago and said, we need a math guy. By the way, I think one of the ways in which Keith has been in the advance of a lot of change in the news business is you can make a compelling case for that now. But from the moment he walked into our studios, and at first it was just going to be a one-off interview about something, he was so compelling, such a good teacher. Couldn't understand that ridiculous accent, of course, but that was part of the charm. And he began, there is no higher compliment in the news business. He began to help us take a fresh look at the world. And that's why Keith has been on our show for 22 years, because a number of times of the year, he's able to find something that nobody else is looking at, or he's able to see a circumstance that nobody else is looking at quite like him and other people that he knows. And it makes us take a fresh glimpse at the world. And that sort of contribution is invaluable. So I'm so glad to be here tonight, my friend, to be able to be for this.
Delighted to have you here, Scott. Really, very pleased. Right. Yes. Okay.
No matter how I dress.
You're supposed to ask me questions.
Well, all right, yeah. Tonight, I'm just going to ask him questions. That's all right. Tonight is the first night of the World Series. There's a game we play in this country called, you're familiar with it, right?
Vaguely.
You can use your hands. Let me put it that way, baseball on a bat. I was startled to learn this week, I didn't know this, that most of the general managers in baseball now are not former players. The pendulum, if you please, has swung over on the data side. They tend to be people who are either from a financial background or some kind of analytical background that they have applied to sports. How do you see this development?
Well, first of all, it means that Amazon and Google will probably end up owning all the baseball teams because they have the expertise to do that. But no, it's
Cindy, why don't
there's
you
a couple of reasons why that's happening. One of the reasons that happens is because there's sufficient elements of randomness in baseball that you can use the behavior of random sequences to make accurate predictions. In fact, if I remember correctly, there was a study done some years ago that we actually talked about on the show, where they looked at all of the good players and they sort of compared their performances with random distributions generated on a computer. And there was only one player that didn't fit the possibility of being random, and that was Babe Ruth. So Babe Ruth apparently wasn't random, but everybody else could be random. Mm-hmm. Incidentally, there's a funny story attached to that, is that that piece that we recorded actually found its way onto a CD that NPR released called Driveway Moments in Sports. And it was about highlights of NPR of things about sports. And the thing we did about this baseball is on there. So I achieved this sort of status of being someone who knew about baseball. And in fact, I was down visiting some mathematicians in Georgia, and they took me to the first ever baseball game I'd been to with the Atlanta Braves. I went there into Turner Field, and it became clear to my hosts within 5 minutes that I had not a clue what this game was about.
Yeah.
At which point they had to ask me, how come you're recognized as an authority on baseball? All I can say is, well, I know about the mathematics, and that's what got me through. But no, I don't know anything about baseball. I hope that the people who are in charge of teams that get there because they're quants do know something about baseball, because otherwise the teams might be in trouble. But yeah, you can make predictions pretty accurately based on statistics.
There's a case that will be heard for the Supreme Court I want to ask you about, because the mathematics has a role perhaps in its resolution, and I'm intrigued by it because it seems to be applying a perspective that, to my knowledge, hasn't been applied before. And of course, that's the case that the court will be taking about gerrymandering.
Oh yeah, the gerrymandering.
Which determines our democracy, really.
Yeah, yeah. So the case that's before the Supreme Court now comes from this case in Wisconsin, which is about the state drink. And for years, whichever party's in power will try to gerrymander things. They will change the districting map so that you can, and it's known as packing and cracking. You want to make sure that your party can win as many districts as possible so that they can take control, which means you want the opposition party to be concentrated in a small number of districts. So you want all of the opposition votes to pile up to give way in excess of needing in maybe 3 or 4 regions, and then you want 9 or 10 regions where they just win. So the trick is to win a lot of regions with just slightly more than 50% and then lose 2 or 3 by huge percentages. And whichever party's in power has done that, and they've been doing it for, and it tends to wash out. And in fact, the Supreme Court, when it has ruled, have said, these things are a washout, it doesn't matter. The difference in the one now is that in Wisconsin, the party that took control was the Republicans, and it's only an anti-Republican story because they happened to be that time in the cycle. At the very moment when the ability to run very, very sophisticated algorithms on the redistricting maps became available, the computing power, the technique, and the know-how, so the Republicans in Wisconsin were able to do for voting what Volkswagen did for emissions tests. Build a system that looks absolutely fair, but is guaranteed to keep them in office for the next 10, 15, 20 years unless there's major changes in the demographics. Yeah. And so that use of computers and sophisticated mathematics is new and clearly is a clear and present danger to democracy. The only way to fight, well, there's two ways to fight it. One is to go back to the idea like we're doing in California of having an independent group that sort of does the districting, or use fight fire with fire. If algorithms are the threat, fight them with algorithms. And in fact, some mathematicians at Duke University recently came up with what seems to me as a plausible way of detecting whether a redistricting map is in fact the result of one of these long random searches, Markov chain searches, to find these things. Because districting maps that have that property, that they look fair but really aren't, they're outliers. That doesn't happen most of the time. And so you need a test to see if a map is an outlier. If it is, you should throw it out. There was a recent article, I think, in the New York Times by Justice Kennedy expressing some skepticism about using maths in the court. Yeah. Unfortunately, math is in the court because it's what's behind the Wisconsin redistrict map.
Yeah. I will point out in the interest of balance in our home state of Illinois, the Democrats have been accused of doing the same thing.
Because Chicago's famous for doing strange things, as you keep teaching me.
Exactly. Not just algorithms, but resurrection. when my mother died a few years ago, I received a condolence note from Senator Durbin of Illinois, who had met my mother on a couple of occasions and said nice things. And then he said, and I hope I will continue to win her vote in the 42nd Ward for many years to come. And that's considered just a compliment in Chicago. What's over the horizon that makes you worry at night?
Oh, good Lord. Well, these days, it's just looking in the Washington Post every morning. So that's as we say, is not normal, right? So, yeah. Which is a term of art in mathematics. I'm actually a pretty optimistic person. I actually don't tend to get depressed. I think, I've lived through enough cycles to know that when you think there's doom inevitable, something comes along and changes. You know, people are adaptable. They change. We're creative. We're resourceful. I just think whatever happens, whether it's outsourcing, whether it's artificial intelligence taking away jobs,
That's why I asked the question. Yeah. Are we up to competing with artificial intelligence, or do I phrase that badly? Is the notion to use it not compete with it?
There's no doubt about it that artificial intelligence, as it becomes more sophisticated and the computers behind it become more powerful, it can do more and more things that really do seem to be intelligent, and in some senses really are intelligent. But by their nature, it's very hard to see them being genuinely creative. You've got to be careful, because when you've got that degree of complexity, they can seem creative because of unexpectedness and surprises. Nevertheless, evolution over millions of years has prepared our brains to be supremely adaptable. The word of art today is plasticity. We can adapt very quickly in a space of weeks, months, and years to a new circumstance. I see nothing that's going on now that's different from things in the past where the new circumstance has just launched us on something new. Can we see it now? By definition, no. If we could, then it wouldn't be different. But a new generation grows up, they look at the world differently, and they will do different things because for them, AI is part of the background. The iPhone is part of their background, the smartphone. I remember getting excited when Steve Jobs got up and showed the first iPhone. I thought that was really cool. Now, it's passé. I mean, my kids would laugh if I took that out of the drawer. I still have my first iPhone.
Do you have your first?
I have my first iPhone. It's a piece of art. Yes.
There's been a lot of violent weather in the past few months. Hurricanes, as we both know with family, there's been, wildfires, certainly aggravated by weather patterns. What can mathematics help us to understand about that?
Well, first of all, it can look at the patterns and make predictions. I mean, this is what the EPA is all about. It's to study what's happening in the environment, and to make predictions as to things that are happening. You know, the recent wildfires in Sonoma, the actual timing wasn't known. Some winds came up during the night, it was hot. But, you know, I ride my bicycle all around Sonoma all of the time and around the Bay Area, and there were all of these posters saying fire danger today high. Everybody knew that after the long, hot, dry summer, there was a fire danger. People were not unaware of that. It wasn't a surprise. It was just one of these unfortunate circumstances that during the night, the wind came up, there was something that caused it, and it just moved very quickly. Mm-hmm. But scientifically, we knew that was going to happen sooner or later somewhere. You know, right now, it may be happening in Southern California. We've got used to it. So it was a tragedy. On the moment, it was a surprise. But nothing happened in California that people hadn't sort of been expecting at the back of their mind. It's just part of living in California. You know, if you live on the East Coast, hurricanes and floods. If you look on the West Coast, actually we don't get hurricanes, we do get floods, and we get fire, and we get earthquakes. But we know about these things. You can't always predict them, but you can take steps. And indeed, California does take steps. They're very careful about giving the warnings and different kinds of days. You know when it's a dangerous day. We don't know what caused those fires, but it was... What made them dangerous was the wind in the middle of the night when people were asleep.
Right. Yeah. And there are mathematical principles that can help us with our calculations of likelihood.
You can make changes to the road systems that make it less likely that the roads will get clogged. There's all sorts of research done. It began with research into buildings. You know, when you have buildings, the worst thing in the world is to have large doors. Yeah. You want small doors or lots of doors with posts in between them. Because if you have a large door, people will crowd through it, and then they'll just block it. If you have a small door, people will go out in a much more orderly fashion, even though fast. So you can simulate these things, and you can find results that show you how to build buildings and how to build highway systems so that you minimize the chances of snarl-ups when lots of people want to move out at the same time.
Yeah. I asked this question, and we're inviting questions from you folks, too. I don't know where Cindy went, but I guess people will just stand up and bark them out. Okay. I asked this, as you know, the father of daughters. Yeah. And I've tried to be scrupulous without bothering you too much with their homework. But are you concerned that, and of course, as you know, they go to all girls' schools, are you concerned that women are discouraged from their exhibiting an interest in math and pursuing it vocationally?
Very discouraged, and I went through it myself when my two daughters were at school, and I saw it happening, even with a father who's a mathematician. By the way, because I'm an inveterate educator, I would never do their homework for them. I would never answer their questions except with another question. So my wife had to take up the slack, because with teenage girls, that's actually not a good strategy. It's easier with students. The worst they can do is give you a bad grade at the end of the semester.
Right, yeah.
With your daughters, they can make life hell. And the wife is always on their side, so there's a danger to doing that. So, it really does bother me, and it's endemic. It's not unique to the United States, but it's not unique to all countries either. Some Eastern European countries don't have that. Mm-hmm. It's part of our culture, it's part of the tradition to make those assumptions about ability. You know, we even had a Harvard president a few years ago saying there were some biological reasons and had to quit the presidency as a result. So we're living in a world where these assumptions are made, and unfortunately they just get passed on. Not willingly, not thinkingly. You know, studies have been done of teachers who were regarded as good teachers, female teachers teaching students, and without realizing it, you know, they tend to respond to boys' questions in a way different to girls' questions. It's just part of being a human. You know, one of the strengths about humans, we're talking about AI, one of the strengths about humans is we go through life.
By the way, not to put you on the spot, how long does it take to serve those desserts? If you calculate the... All right, go ahead. Yeah. I just thought we could use a little
object
lesson here.
Don't ask me to do arithmetic in public. I always suck at arithmetic, right. And I still do. The invention of the electronic calculator helps me become a mathematician. Mm-hmm. So, these things just get passed on. They're part of it. And the studies have shown that, you know, they just treat the two genders differently. But it's partly because our strength as people, as humans, is we are able to make all sorts of discussions very quickly. We use heuristics. We are not logical creatures, we're analogical creatures. We reason using heuristics, and over the generations, when society was structured differently, we built heuristics about boys can do this, girls can do that. But now the technologies have reached a stage, the way we live our lives, means that in many countries, there's really no distinction between the two genders, or there shouldn't be. But unfortunately, it's part of our cultural heritage that those things are there. So even people with the best intentions in the world subconsciously make those errors, and they get passed on. It's a really difficult thing to overcome. Yeah. There is motion, the needle is moving, but it's moving very slowly.
Let's take a question, if we can. I'll try and... Am I missing someone? Oops, sorry. What would that do? Keith is marvelously complete, and there are no questions. What are you working on now?
I'm putting most of my efforts into building mathematics learning video games. I co-founded a company a couple of years ago called Brainquake that makes mobile games for teaching, not just teaching mathematics, helping people learn to be mathematics and for assessing mathematical ability. I actually learned how to do that working for the Defense Department for 12 years. Post 9/11, I worked indirectly for the CIA, then I worked for the Navy, then I worked for the Army, and it was always about improving the ability to analyze intelligence. In the case of the Defense Department, the problems are so big and so intractable that it was really hard to do anything other than improve intelligence analysis by 1 or 2 percentage points because of the complexity. But in thinking about all of the difficulties of doing that, I had various insights into how you could help a kid in a classroom, because a child in a classroom is like an intelligence analyst at the Pentagon. You're faced with incoming information you have to make sense of. That's what the intelligence analysts do. That's what the people, that's what kids do in the classroom. And so all of the 12 years I spent working for the Defense Department built up a lot of expertise in how you would build video games to engage kids and get them to develop mathematical skills. Actually, not mathematical skills, but metacognitive skills and mathematical ability. We're a little bit unusual. We don't build games to develop skills. We build games to develop thinking capacity, the ability to deal with a novel problem. Because in today's world, on your iPhone, you can access a resource, several resources, that would take any university math exam in the world and get at the very least a B+ and very often an A. We now have systems that do for the whole of mathematics what the calculator did for arithmetic in the 60s. The world our kids come out of schools to study in is a world in which those tools are available on the cloud. That means doing mathematics is a very, very different activity than it was even 20 years ago.
Every now and then, there's a popular entertainment that comes along where the mathematician is the hero.
Yeah, I've worked on some of those series.
I know you've been a consultant, I know. Yeah. And they're invariably, for reasons I understand, well, because they're patterned on you. They're lively, sexy, incredibly charming and accomplished people.
Yeah, of course. of these people know me, so you're not going to get away with that.
Oh, then I understand the groans. despite the fact that they've so often consulted with you, what do popular entertainments often get wrong about math and mathematicians and people who use it in their lives?
Not just the ones I've been involved with, some of them, they're actually getting more things right than they used to. They almost always now have a mathematical consultant. They did with the Ramanujan one recently, with the MoMath connection, with that photo we saw. So they tend to be getting it more and more accurately correct now. The days when, there's still a lot of bad stuff, but people like Ron Howard, for example, when they make a movie now, they really go to pains to get the mathematics right. So there's been far fewer movies where I've sort of groaned about it, where I thought, no, that was really a bad portrayal. It's still the case, you know, I worked on this CBS series Numbers for several years. You know, to make it exciting, they have to compress everything into something that could happen over a few days, whereas mathematics is slow. It takes place over weeks or months or years. So the only unrealistic thing that's of significance, I think, is it gives the impression, and CSI does the same thing in chemical forensics, biological forensics, it gives the impression that this is fast and it's exciting. It's not, it's slow and exciting. So the idea of speed, you have to telescope speed to make the thing fun to watch and engaging. That is totally unrealistic. But apart from that, I think they get it, by and large, pretty well accurate these days. Mm-hmm. I mean, you could nitpick, but I'm just talking about the essence.
Are there any more questions? Yes, sir.
The implications, the ability of these techniques. I wrote about this in the Huffington Post at the beginning of this year. I had two articles. One was titled, "Everything I Learned as a Math Major Became Obsolete in My Lifetime," which is absolutely true in the sense of I no longer need to do any of those things in any of the projects I worked on. The follow-up article was, what does that mean for mathematics education? And it really means, since you have at your fingertips the ability to run all of these procedures, you have to be able to use those procedures and those tools. That means you need a very high level, but penetrating understanding. So the simple take-home message, which is already on board with many teachers, is don't teach for procedural execution, teach for understanding. A machine will do the execution, you have to teach for understanding. Because a machine is a machine is a machine, and if you think it understands, you're in a dangerous place, because it doesn't and it can't. So you have to teach people to be able to make intelligent use of machines in order to solve problems, real world problems or mathematical problems. So it's teaching for understanding. You still have to know what it's about. For example, you'd need to know how to solve linear equations in two unknowns. In the classroom, you never need to go to three. There's nothing special about three. Most equations in the world have hundreds of unknowns. Teach it for one to two. That gets the understanding. Then just let the machines take over from then. So it's really teach for understanding. That one thing alone should make a huge difference.
As usual, Keith, they have to drag us out of there. If I forget to say something in your honor tonight, I was startled to hear, and I guess I've heard this before, that American children are so far down in the world when it comes to mastery of mathematics skills. I like to think, because we inevitably hear people come to work to us as interns and young producers who say, well, you know, I grew up listening to NPR in the back of the car. I was kind of a prisoner. My parents made me listen. I like to think, if just 10% of those youngsters could hear you and decide, I'm really interested in math, I think I'm going to make a life in math, it could make a difference. And I do know that
there are some kids who've done that, because they occasionally tell me that. You know, they say they've heard me on the radio or they've read the books.
Right.
And so that's kind of nice when you hear that. 10% seems a bit high.
All right.
But I'll settle for 2 or 3%, actually.
All right.
I'll settle for 0.5%.
Well, Keith Devlin, thank you very much.
Thank you, Scott. Much appreciated.
And my final task of the evening is to call Tim Nissen back up, who has some awards that we would like to present to both Keith Devlin and Scott Simon. So if you would both also join us in our gratitude for your, both of you, doing some tremendous flying today to get here. Thank you.
All right, so Keith, You will notice, everybody, you'll notice, of course, I'm sure you have, it's been impossible to ignore the pineapples in the middle of your tables, and there are some supporting pine cones. And Keith can describe the importance of these for this evening's event.
Okay, interesting tactic. I get an award, but first I have to work to earn my reward. Okay, you're looking at the pine cones and the pineapple, because those are two examples of things you find in the natural world that embody the Fibonacci sequence. If you were to take the pine cone out, I'm not sure whether you could, or you to take the pineapple out and you look at it, you'll find those spirals going round one way. You have to maybe squint, and spirals going round the other way. If you look at the pine cone and you look at the base, you see the same thing happening, and sometimes you can see them with some pine cones from the side. But they spiral round, and if you count the number of spirals, you'll typically get a pair of numbers like 8 and 13, successive Fibonacci numbers. It was actually only relatively recently, maybe a few decades ago, that scientists discovered the mechanics that led to the appearance of the Fibonacci numbers. It's because the Fibonacci numbers are approximations to the golden ratio, and nature loves the golden ratio because when it grows to optimize nutrition and ability to collect from the sun, it tends to move things around in what you can prove mathematically is the angle that's most suited to optimize life. And that angle is the golden ratio. And since you can only have an exact number of things like spirals, you get whole number approximations. So you get Fibonacci numbers. So we do now have an explanation of why some things in the garden, like pineapples and pine cones, have Fibonacci numbers in their growth structure.
And so as Keith has brought so many touchstones of mathematics to us, like a pine cone you can find on the forest floor or a pineapple you can find in a grocery store, we present an honorary pine cone to Keith Devlin. And Scott Simon as a broadcaster. Scott Simon is a broadcaster of so many ideas to the nation and the world. As a pine cone broadcasts its seeds, here is a pine cone for you, sir.
You've never got one of those before, have you, Scott?
I've never gotten one of them before. No, now I don't know why I've lived so long without.
Oops, and mine fell off. Okay.
Let's give a thank you to both of our presenters here and honorees.
And thank you to everyone for coming tonight and for supporting the nation's only Museum of Math. We hope we'll see you the last Tuesday in February at the MoMath Masters. Mark your calendars, and we'll see you then.